We now welcome our first fighter to the cage, Mario Aldana.
Sold out Hard Rock Live in Sacramento, California. 2,000 plus fans will be packing this place tonight. As this is the A1 Combat YouTube, we are proud to present to you the preliminary bouts for A1 Combat 19, which will go live on UFC Fight Pass at 7 Pacific Standard Time. Johnny LaQuasso here alongside my amazing broadcast partner, 8-3 as a professional in the cage, one of the youngest rising stars in UFC. She's a strawweight. She's amazing. She is Corey McKenna. Corey, tonight, by the end of this night, we might be dehydrated. We have a lot of fights on our hands. All very exciting.
Yeah, very busy night on the books today. I didn't understand that. Or is he? And the music cut. Oh, okay.
All right, bit of a delay here. Some technical issues, but Corey McKenna, you're here now. Feel free. You have the floor. Say whatever you would like to kick off this broadcast.
Well, apparently you guys could hear me talking regardless. Like I was saying, I'm very excited for the fights here tonight. I think that we have a few preliminary fights that have potential to be fight of the nights. I'm very excited for this one coming in here. You know, Mario Aldana, he's riding a 3-fight win streak. He's coming off a first round TKO within 2 minutes of the fight. And, you know, he brought a lot of energy to the weigh-ins and to the fight tonight with his mask and everything. So super excited.
And switching coaches recently has really paid dividends, but let's go for the next introduction.
Set now his opponent, Gino Pahani.
Gino Pahlani coming in 1-0 thus far as an amateur, weighed in at an even 150 yesterday for weigh-ins. In incredible condition, actually does tons of cross training to keep his conditioning up. And this is his first fight since December of 2022. That was a victorious debut via decision. And, you know, that's the beautiful thing about these prelims, Corey, and these amateur fights. A lot of hungry fighters trying to get to that next level.
Yeah, definitely. As you mentioned, I know Gino's done a lot of cross training. He's fighting out of Unbreakable Fitness, which I believe is crossed with Kaiju under Johnny Go. He's also trained at Team Alpha Male a little bit, and I believe he has also been over at MMA Gold getting experience sparring there. So, you know, a guy that's definitely been trying to hone his skills and sharpen. And as you mentioned, we haven't seen him since 2022, but he has appeared to have been working. And I'm very excited to see what he brings to the cage here tonight.
And our main event tonight, of course, in the prelims, Rafael Vega, Eddie McCleary for the A1 Combat Amateur Welterweight title. And we will be right back to kick off the prelims.
Defended by the young Titan. Wow. Oh! He gives him a Uriah.
Carly Chandler with an opportunity to tap out the goal.
Amazing night of fights from top to bottom.
Ladies and gentlemen, good evening and welcome to A1 Combat 19, streaming live on the A1 Combat YouTube channel. We begin our prelims with 3 2-minute rounds at a contract weight of 150 pounds. Introducing first, the blue corner. Standing 5'7" tall, weighing 150.6 pounds, on a three-fight win streak, he returns to A1 Combat 3-3 as an amateur, representing Thomas Fallon MMA from Sacramento, California, Mario Mimascaras Altana. And now we introduce the red corner. Standing 5'7" tall, weighing 150 pounds, 1-0 early in his amateur career, representing Unbreakable Combat Fitness from Kelseyville, California, please welcome Gino Polani. Your referee, David Shirley.
It is now time to get the prelims underway for A1 Combat 19. Hard Rock Live, the fans slowly filing in here. Massive moment here for Gino Polani and Mario Aldana.
One thing I noted when I was looking into Mario Aldana a little bit, I watched a couple of his highlights and his fight clips, obviously. He's very aggressive with his forward pressure. He's had some really big slams, some vicious ground and pound. And I'm kind of expecting him to come out here really aggressive here tonight.
And speaking of Aldana, very interesting story. He's 3-3 as an amateur. Started off 0-3, switched over to Tom Fallon. And guess what? Since then, undefeated 3-0. It's amazing what the right switch can do for a fighter.
Yeah, you know, Tom Fallon's a great coach. He's recently opened a gym not too far from here. And as you mentioned, you know, quite a few fighters have switched over there. I think he's got 2 or 3 fighters on the card here tonight. And yeah, definitely made a change for Mario Aldana.
And to be clear, these are 2-minute rounds, 150-pound catch weight fight to kick us off tonight.
I feel like I spoke too soon a little bit. You know, Mario seems to be filling it out a little bit. Oh, big heavy hook there. But Gino appears to be the one holding the center, applying a little bit of pressure. Both guys just filling each other out a little bit, maybe respecting each other a little bit more than they need to. But, you know, both very powerful guys, as you can see, just from looking at them.
Aldana trying to create a little spacing with the jab here. Oh, nice combination there by Polani.
And just a note, the guys are wearing shin pads because per California Commission, if one or both fighters have less than 3 fights, they are required to wear shin pads in the state of California. So with Gino only having 1 amateur fight, that's why we're wearing shin pads here tonight.
And speaking of California rules, you'll notice tonight in the title fights, they are going to be 3 rounds on the main card due to specific rules in California. We're also going to make history. We're going to crown the first ever men's strawweight championship.
Yeah, I'm really excited.
Nice takedown. Beautiful. Single leg there by Polani.
Beautiful job by Polani. Great job from Mario, though, to scoop straight back to the cage, use that to work up to his feet. Very aware in this position. Oh, Gino's got to be careful. Mario appears to be fishing for a guillotine, but I don't think that's quite in, and we're short on time. So.
That'll do it for round one. And
these rounds fly so quick at amateur.
You'd have to believe that takedown very well could have won Polani that round, as it was very even up until the final 15 seconds.
Yeah, I definitely think that, you know, with Gino holding the center, pushing the pressure a little bit, you know, obviously he wasn't coming forward heavy, but, you know, Aldana was circling the perimeter. And then obviously that takedown at the end, I do think that would secure him that first round. I'd like to see these guys start turning it up a little bit. As I mentioned before, Aldana has had multiple fights where he is very aggressive coming forward. So I'd like to see him use that to his advantage.
Well, as we take a look at the prelim card here, coming up next, we're going to have Amarius Taylor, Michael Seeley, lightweight bout. We're going to go back to catchweight 165. Hidalgo and Pitts. Very intriguing featherweight bout between Kyler Avila, Conor Galloway. And this really could have fight of the night as far as prelims. Kevin Falcone, Eric Cortez. That's going to be a lot of fun.
Yeah, that one's going to be a banger for sure. I'm very excited for those prospects.
Then we have Chase Miles and Walter Shaw leading up to the welterweight title fight in our main event of the prelims, leading up to six fights on the main card live on Fight Pass.
Nice job there from Mario Aldana's jab to the body, you know, mixing up the levels a little bit, giving Gino something more to think about. Definitely seems to be turning it on a little bit more now as we come out in the second round. Nice.
Aldana came close on the cross there. Mario Aldana in the black trunks, Gino Polani in the purple. Ooh, nice leg kick.
Nice kicks from Gino. Aldana throws that overhand like he's holding nothing back. You know what I mean? If one of those lands, that could be a rough night for Gino. But I'm loving the use of the jabs here. I like the kicks from Gino. Both guys are looking good here, you know, very early in their careers, and both looking very composed and very present.
If you're Polani, do you think, do you expect him to maybe shoot back in, considering it was successful in the end of the first round?
Nice connection there on that backhand, but I think so. I think he hit that takedown pretty easily. I'd like to see maybe if he could do something with it this time. As we mentioned, these rounds are very short, so you know, to get into a trade-off for 2 minutes, it can be quite hard on the judges' scorecards. So I definitely think something like that to seal the deal would be a good idea.
As a fighter, how much of a difference does that that 2 minute round versus 3 minute round make as far as your confidence to really go for it?
I've never done a 2 minute round. That is I believe that's a California thing.
Okay.
Yeah, the shortest round I've ever done is 3 minutes. And you know, we generally train 5 minutes, so it definitely does feel a lot faster. With the guys that I coach, the amateur out here, like I make them do 2 minute rounds just so they can kind of get the feel of like how fast that flies. Oh, nice level change for Gino, and he finishes it. He's doing a great job of shooting these takedowns towards the latter of the round, because it's kind of like we mentioned before, he's kind of sealing the deal in the judges' eyes. I'd like to see him maybe do it a bit earlier so we can see what he can do with it.
Yeah.
But I do think in a close round, that should seal the deal with the judges. I think he should be up too. But both guys, you know, both guys are throwing heat on their strikes, and definitely, you know, pretty close. Like I say, the rounds are short. But I'd like to see Aldana kind of push urgency here now coming out in this third.
But like you said, almost identical finishes in the first and second round. Polani, very powerful base, and he just followed all the way through with that takedown. As like you said, a lot of solid exchanges here between these two fighters.
Yeah, and as we see in these replays, that was a beautiful level change. Gino ran his feet, ran him straight down. And like I say, Aldana's doing a great job of getting back to the cage so he can start working up to his feet immediately. But because it's the later part of the round, he doesn't really have time to do anything with it. So I'd be interested in seeing Gino maybe shoot a little bit earlier, see if he's got any offense on the ground. But I do think he's doing a good job of playing it smart. In regards to the striking, I feel like we're a little tit for tat right now. You know, both guys are throwing heat in their overhands and their hooks. But I do feel like it's quite close on the feet. I'd like to see Aldana push the pace a little bit and really try to make a statement coming out in this third round.
Third and final round here. Opening fight of the prelims for A1 Combat 19. Nice jab there, nice.
Ooh, beautiful.
Follows up with a leg kick.
Ooh, some nice kicks there from Gino. Okay, Aldana deciding to press it up against the cage now, changing the direction of the fight a little bit. Let's see how his offensive wrestling is. Good job from Gino digging that underhook.
Yeah.
You know, he's doing a great job to stay up on his feet. Aldana almost had his hands locked from the looks, looking to elevate. But Gino's doing a great job of spreading his legs, digging that underhook. He's got the lift.
Oh, Aldana though.
And there's that slam I was talking about. Good job from Gino to stay with his base, get on top in that close guard. Very impressed here for you know, a 1-0 guy. As we mentioned, maybe that that traveling around, getting experience at different gyms and training with different people, like coming into play here a little bit. You know, there's a lot of preparation that goes in outside of fighting.
Sure.
He looks very composed and experienced beyond his one fight right here.
Tremendous conditioning on behalf of both Aldana and Polani is now. Oh. Polani's got Aldana up against the cage. Final 40 seconds of round three.
Aldana grabbed the cage a couple times there, had to get warned by our referee, but great job from both guys here. You know, like I say, great job to get back to his feet. He's digging that underhook. And Gino's just relentless in this position right here. Just sticking to him.
For the most part, it's really been the power of Polani that's kind of had the strongest moments throughout these three rounds.
Yeah, like I mentioned, like it's been pretty close, and it's really hard to score these two-minute rounds. I just feel like guys don't have enough time to work.
Perhaps that could have been, you know, we noticed both take. Oh, nice right hand by Polani in the final 15 seconds of this round. That is a strong flurry to finish.
Great job from Polani to stay aware on that break there. That's when a lot of people get tagged. You know, you get complacent, you just let go of the guy, and, like, I feel like that happens often, you know. And great job from Polani to capitalize on that and land that big strike.
And perhaps it's difficult as a fighter in, like you mentioned, the two-minute rounds to time everything out. You know, both takedowns were in the waning seconds of round one and two.
Yeah, well, you look at some fights, like fighters spend the first minute or so feeling each other out, and at this level, you only have 2 minutes for a whole round, so you don't really have any feeling out time. And in a way, it creates exciting fights because you kind of have to press urgency from the bell, but at the same time, it can kind of shoot people in the foot if they get a little bit too comfortable, a little bit too slow in there.
Well, thank you all for joining us live on YouTube. Make sure you head over to Fight Pass, 7 p.m. Pacific for A1 Combat 19. This is the first of our 7 fights on the prelims. And on the main card, 3 title fights. We will crown the first ever A1 Combat men's strawweight title. And as far as I know, this might be the first men's strawweight title in North America. We'll double check on that. Then in the co-main event, the vacant middleweight title is on the line. Two absolute beasts. Henderson Fajeda and Kevin Felipe Sampaio Cancini. That will be a firefight. It will be hard-hitting. And yes, Corey, I got his name correct.
That fight is going to be insane. Yeah. Probably my fight of the night. Kevin's a little crazy, and his opponent seems just as terrifying, so I'm very excited for that fight here as a fan.
Fajeda is coming off 2 consecutive bare-knuckle victories on top of an 18-5-1 record. It is going to be as good as advertised, and then, of course, in the main event, the featherweight title will be on the line as we await the decision.
Ladies and gentlemen, after 3 rounds of action-packed action here at our opening contest, at A1 Combat 19 prelims, we go to your 3 judges at cageside for the decision. Your first judge, Chad Shepard, scored the contest 29-28. All judges, John Mobley and Brendan Saucedo, see it 30-27. All for your winner by unanimous decision, Gino Polani.
Well, Corey, the judges saw that fight exactly how you did.
Yeah, exactly. Like I said, I think he just did a good job of making a statement at the end of each round with the takedowns. I understand, obviously, striking does score more highly in the judges' favor these days, but yeah, definitely a good decision here tonight.
Well, congratulations to Gino Polani moving to 2-0 in his young career. Tremendous performance tonight. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the prelims for A1 Combat 19. It's catchweight time, 140-pound catchweight fight.
Oh, keep talking.
Welcome back to the prelims for A1 Combat 19. Coming up next, hi everyone. We have a 140-pound catchweight fight coming up. It'll be 3 rounds, 3 minutes each round. And Corey, we're off to a great start as we see this place slowly starting to fill up.
Yeah, exactly. We've got an action-packed card here tonight. Very excited. The prelims are packed with great talent, and then the main card is just insane.
Absolutely. I think right now we're just awaiting the announcement from the great Garrett Berte.
And now, first we welcome to the cage, Amaria Taylor.
Sack live for Amarius Taylor. Coming in 3-2 as an amateur with two knockouts, weighed in yesterday at 143.1, currently on a three-fight win streak, including a first-round knockout back in June of last year. Very impressive striker, also very long reach. He's got a lot of range.
Yeah, I'm really excited for this one coming in. You know, he's riding a three-fight win streak. His two losses were by decision, but he's coming off a first-round knockout in 15 seconds. So the guy's got finishing power and, you know, definitely exuding confidence at the weigh-ins. Seemed very confident coming out here tonight. So I'm really excited to see if he can bring that finishing power out.
Once again, 140-pound catch weight. He came in at 143.1. The second of our seven prelim fights tonight. And we have so much coming up with A1 Combat, Corey. May 17th, A1 Combat 20, right back here at Hard Rock Live in Sacktown. And then May 25th, A1 Combat 21 in Visalia, where our very own Uriah Faber is going to be competing.
And now, please welcome his opponent, Michael Seeley.
Michael Seeley coming in 2-1 in his amateur career. One knockout, one submission. Weighed in yesterday at 145.6. Tonight, his first trip to the cage in since November of 22. But looking at his Instagram, lacking confidence is not something that is an issue for him.
Yeah, definitely. Like we mentioned, both these guys have finishing power coming in here tonight. They're both very confident young men, and I don't see this fight going to the scorecards personally. Like you said, he hasn't fought since November 2022. I believe he was supposed to fight Malik, a guy from Team Alpha Male, last December. However, there was complications at the event, and that fight ended up getting scrapped. So not too sure what the layoff was, but I'm sure he's been away working hard, and I'm very excited for this fight right here. Two very promising prospects.
Seeley says his jiu-jitsu has become much stronger over the past year plus. We'll see if he's able to make that happen in the cage in just a few moments. Michael Seeley, Amarius Taylor, 140-pound catch weight. All right, now let's kick it back to Garrett Fertig for the announcement.
A1 Combat continues our prelims in the featherweight division, scheduled for 3 3-minute rounds, presented by Hoffman Excavation. And now we introduce first the blue corner, standing 6 feet tall, weighing 143.1 pounds, 3-2 as an amateur, including a 15-second stoppage victory in his last fight, representing Klingens MMA and Kickboxing from Yuba City, California. Please welcome Amarius Taylor. And now introducing his opponent across the cage, fighting out of the red corner, standing 5'7" tall, his official weight 145.6 pounds, holding an amateur record of 2 wins, 1 loss, one of his 2 wins coming by submission, representing Gracie Fighter Stockton from San Andreas, California, Michael Seeley. Your referee, Mike Ventron.
Well, Corey, I've just been told it's officially now a featherweight bout. This was initially going to be catchweight, but both Seeley and Taylor came in, 145.6 and 143.1.
Yeah, perfect. Must be, you know, emotions must be running high in the Seeley corner. You know, we've got Gracie Fighter Stockton, very confident bunch, but also we have Ernie Juarez fighting later tonight for the to defend his title.
Absolutely.
So, you know, team preparation coming in here tonight, but straight off the bat for Taylor.
Oh!
He is wasting no time.
Taylor using that range early on as the great Mike Beltran will be officiating. 3 minute rounds in this amateur clash, and wow.
Beautiful level change there from Amaris Taylor. As I said, both these guys have finishing power, very aggressive styles, very confident styles, and we're definitely seeing Steely come out and implement his game plan here tonight. I'm loving the head pressure in here. It doesn't look like much, but it really does a great job of throwing off your opponent, you know, that head pressure allowing you to grind him down a little bit.
Well, Steely said he'd be comfortable if it went to the ground, and it went down there early. Wow.
Swing and a miss for Steely, but
such a distinct reach advantage for Taylor. Another takedown.
Smart job there from Taylor. You know, Steely kind of tried to egg him on a little bit. He cracked him with that hook, kind of like tried to egg him on and to get in a bit of a slugfest. But he stayed composed, level changed, got that takedown, and he's doing a good job at sticking to his game plan and not getting drawn into a slugfest.
Yeah, Taylor's really locked in.
Nice.
Now
beautiful
a collection
knees.
Of left knees, three in a row. And once again, look at my, a spine buster.
And Steely is almost making this easier for Taylor. Like, he's kind of jumping guard as he's level changing, which is a great job if he has an offensive guard and he is a jiu-jitsu player from that position. However, it's not great in terms of getting up to your feet and staying on the feet. Obviously, I would love to see if Steely has offense down here. He seems confident, like you mentioned, to be jumping to that guard, but definitely, I don't want to say he's giving Amaris the takedowns, but definitely making it easier for him.
Well, thus far, 3 for 3. Taylor is showing impressive power. I mean, Arn Anderson would have been proud of that takedown with the impact.
Taylor's doing a great job of following the hips in here too, not allowing Steely to, you know, get to a hip, start setting up submissions. He's keeping his head in line with the cage, which stops him from being able to get his butt back and start scooting up. He's doing a great job just staying positionally aware here. Ooh, that was...
Oh my!
That's it!
Oh!
TKO knockout for Amaris Taylor!
A right uppercut lands square for Amaris Taylor!
Just like that, another first-round knockout for Amaris Taylor.
That's right. Down goes Steely, and you can see the eye is opened up. Steely is very distraught with good reason, and Corey, Amaris Taylor took complete control of this fight from the opening seconds, whether it was the takedown or the consistent strikes, and it was that uppercut that completely rocked Michael Steely.
As I said coming out, this fight was not going to go the distance. But, you know, not taking anything away from Steely. He looked great out there. But, very promising prospect for Amaris Taylor. Phenomenal performance here tonight. Great job just coming out here, implementing his game plan, pushing the pressure, and not really giving Steely any time to ease into the fight at all. Like, you know, he took that away from him and just went out there and put a stamp on the fight.
Well, you mentioned previously Taylor had a 15-second knockout. This knockout in the first round, and he's really starting to catch his groove here, moving to 4-2 as an amateur. As we're going to go back and check out some of the impressive offense here by Amaris Taylor with the collection of knees here. And now the powerful takedown. And it's all going to lead up to this moment. Boom, look at that uppercut. Follows up with a hook. And Corey, that was curtains.
Yeah, that was brutal. Beautifully timed. You know, he dipped down, kind of like faked it, and then he loaded it with all of his body. That was a brutal uppercut, followed it with the hook, and he did a great job of staying on him. You know, the fight's not over till the ref jumps in.
Well, that's certainly what Beltran had to do as we go to Garrett Furtick for the announcement.
Ladies and gentlemen, referee Mike Beltran steps in and waves off the contest. Official time, 2 minutes, 31 seconds of the very first round. Declaring your winner by TKO due to ref stoppage, Amaris Taylor.
You can hear the ovation for Amaris Taylor. He has a strong showing tonight of fans. And what a feeling it must be for him to be in this kind of spotlight here for A1 Combat and to be so dominant in a first round knockout.
Yeah. Yeah, what a way to kick off the card here tonight. You know what I mean? I was just saying, amazing way to start the card here tonight, and I'm just excited to see how the rest of the card's going to play out.
Absolutely. That's only the second fight of the prelims. Don't go anywhere. Garrett Fertig, take it away.
And now, making his way to the cage, Michael Pitts.
It's now time for a 165-pound catchweight fight. Michael Pitts making his way to the cage. 1-0 as an amateur with a knockout. Went to battle for the first time in his career back in December. Walked away with a knockout in round two. Also was a Division I boxer, boxed at UC Davis for a collegiate career. So very precise and strong striker is Michael Pitts.
Yeah, and Michael Pitts, he actually also trains with Gino Baloney, Kaiju. You know, Gino just got a win the fight before last. So, you know, got to be feeling good coming out for this one, seeing your teammate win, and hoping to continue the trend here tonight. I actually saw that knockout that he got last year, and it was absolutely brutal. So very exciting to see if he can come out here and, you know, make a statement again.
Michael Pitts looking locked in, entering the cage for the second time in his amateur career. Once again on the main card. Join us on Fight Pass. We have three title fights. The feature, co-main, and main will all have gold up for grabs. History being made, the inaugural A1 Combat Strawweight Championship. The vacant middleweight title is on the line, as well as the featherweight title in our main event.
I believe we have an equipment issue. Seems to be fixed. Not too sure what's going on there, but a little delay and ready to get on into the cage and bring out our third fight of the night.
That's right. While we have a moment, tell the people watching at home, how are you feeling after the past couple of weeks? You're healing pretty well?
Yep, I'm doing good. I'm excited to be back here at A1 Combat calling these fights. Like you say, we've got a great night ahead of us. Ready to bring in the blue corner for fight number three of the night.
Let's kick it to Garrett Fertig.
His opponent ready now. Please welcome Dominic Hidalgo.
Dominic Hidalgo making his way to the cage. Impressive run thus far as an amateur, 5-0, making his second trip.
Yeah. Dominic Hidalgo is a very promising prospect coming out here. Like you mentioned, he's 5-0 as an amateur. He last fought less than 3 weeks ago.
Yep.
So he's staying very active, which, you know, we love to see at the amateur level. Amateur is all about just gaining experience, preparing yourself for those pro leagues. And I'm sure an impressive victory here tonight over Michael Pitts, who, as we mentioned, also is a very promising prospect. Surely will, boost him well on his way to those pro ranks.
Absolutely, Hidalgo. All five victories have come in just over 13 months. Four wins via unanimous decision, one from a split decision. So, although not having a finish yet, obviously gaining valuable cage experience going the distance in all five fights.
Yeah, exactly. And, as we mentioned, Michael Pitts comes in here with a brutal knockout. So I'm sure that he's going to be pushing the pace, and it's going to almost force Dominic to kind of step up, and we'll see who comes out on top here tonight.
Both fighters in the cage. Garrett Fertig, take it away.
North Carolina Cycling presents our next prelim bout, set now for three 3-minute rounds at a contract weight of 165 pounds. And now we introduce first the blue corner. Standing 6 feet tall, his official weight 165.1 pounds, undefeated in his amateur career at 5 and O, representing Waffle House and Team Black from Pittsburgh, California. Please welcome Dominic Hidalgo. And now introducing his opponent, fighting out of the red corner, standing 5'8" tall, weighing 165.7 pounds, returning to A1 Combat 1-0, representing Kaju BJJ and UCD Boxing Club from Davis, California, Michael Pitts. Your referee, Herb Dean.
The great Herb Dean at the helm for this fight. Michael Pitts fighting out of the red corner and Dominic Hidalgo out of the blue. Pitts came in yesterday 165.7, Hidalgo 165.1 at weigh-ins. So Corey, if you're Michael Pitts, would you want to keep this fight vertical?
I don't know, I think it's too early to say, really. Like I say, obviously Pitts has finishing power, but both guys coming out great teams, you know. Oh, wow. Beautiful level change from Dominic early in this round. Guess he heard you.
Shooting in quickly there, but Pitts back to his feet.
Oh, beautiful reversal attempt there from Pitts. Good job to stay on his feet, using that cage to get back up. And Hidalgo's just relentless here. He's insistent on that takedown, doing a great job switching between the single leg and the double leg.
And Pitts' corner telling him look for the single.
Pitts is staying active, you know, he's landing strikes and stuff. I'd like to see him start digging an underhook and start working to reverse off of the cage instead of staying in this position. Obviously, he's landing offense in the eyes of the judges, but he is risking giving up this takedown from Hidalgo. I dare say there's a clear game plan here from the Hidalgo corner, and he finally succeeds in finishing that takedown, so let's see what he's been working on here tonight.
Well, as you said, Hidalgo is certainly relentless.
Yeah, and as we mentioned, like, you know, someone who's got heavy hitting power like Pitts, you know, sometimes you got to respect it and you got to take them where they're less comfortable.
Yeah.
Great job from Pitts. Now he's finally off the cage. He's able to push the pressure a little bit and he's landing some heavy strikes here already.
Pitts has a powerful left and now, oh! Pepper and Hidalgo a little bit there. Oh!
He shot into that kick right there.
Now a combination from Pitts. Hidalgo shooting in once again.
I think Hidalgo might be a little bit rocked here.
Yeah.
Kick was nasty, beautifully timed. He's gonna be careful hanging out on his leg. The referee's gonna be taking a look.
Hidalgo is busted open around the right eye. No doubt from one of those powerful lefts by Pitts, and now he's just starting to tee off. And Corey, you're right, Hidalgo is having a difficult time covering up here.
I just wanna mention also how composed Pitts is here in this position. A lot of guys would have rushed in, overcommitted, and gotten taken down by that, you know, that countless shot that Hidalgo took. But Pitts is just staying composed, he's staying at his range, and he's just picking him apart here. Very impressed with Pitts.
The striking skills really coming into play for Michael Pitts. Once again, a boxer at UC Davis. Final seconds of round one. Can Hidalgo survive?
Yeah, I think we're going to see the second round right here, but you know, Hidalgo is relentless on that takedown.
All pro fighters,
I think, from what we've seen so far, he may need to be.
CSAC. Once again, all pro fighters need to report to the back to CSAC in the back immediately.
Michael Pitts landing some powerful jabs. A nice hook there in the first round.
You know, obviously his corner's going to be making adjustments in there. Personally, I think he needs to set up those takedowns a little better. Like he shot straight into that kick. He's not really using his strikes to set up his takedowns, and I think that's allowing Pitts to almost see them coming. We're going to have a replay here shortly of the first round. Boom. Here, displaying those kicks here from Pitts. And see, Hidalgo's almost like, I hate the phrase desperation shots, but it does almost come off like that. You know, he's kind of just dropping straight down on those legs, and there's that kick that he ate on that level change attempt. I think he just needs to put something in the face of Pitts to kind of give him something to respect to open up those legs for the takedowns, because right now he's just diving into offense, and with the finishing power of Pitts, that's potential for an early night.
I mean, there were moments where Pitts was able to tee off, and Pitts has a bullseye there under the right eye of Dominic Hidalgo here at the start of round two. Once again, in our main event of the prelims, welterweight title will be on the line.
One thing to note with Pitts also, maybe, you know, leading back to that boxing experience that he has, he's doing a great job with that foot fight. You know, he's a southpaw, he's fighting an orthodox, and generally we talk about that foot fight with the lead foot. He's keeping his foot. If you notice, he's actually stepping on the toes of Hidalgo sometimes, probably by accident, but he's also coming around the outside and keeping his foot outside of Hidalgo, which allows him to cut him off and is opening up that backhand that we see him landing constantly.
Great.
Jeez, again into that kick.
Creating a lot of spacing with his kicks as well.
Yeah, it's... Hidalgo really needs to be careful diving in on that. He's eaten some heavy offense on his entries, and...
And obviously, you're the expert here. It appears that Hidalgo's... He's diving right in without moving his head to the safer position.
Yeah, and that's why, I hate the phrase desperation strikes, but desperation shots, but sometimes, like, I feel like guys just get on that, like, oh, I gotta go, and they just dive straight in at the legs, and Pitts is very composed here. He's using those opportunities to land those head kicks and those big shots, and Hidalgo's almost, like, shooting into them, and it adds power, you know what I mean? It's a collision.
Hidalgo landed a shot to the nose of Pitts.
Uh-oh. Accidental low blow here. Good respect from Hidalgo. Yeah. He's apologizing.
Yeah, brief stoppage here.
Luckily, something that I don't really have to worry about too much in my career, but...
Understood.
Yeah, it's unfortunate. Maybe fortunate for the Hidalgo corner, you know, give him a second to recompose and... Very impressed with Pitts. You know, like we mentioned, Hidalgo has a lot of experience coming in here tonight, but Pitts is definitely looking to me to be the calmer, more collected fighter.
Yeah, I mean, like we mentioned, Hidalgo, this is his sixth fight in just over a year, and he's won every single one of them. Pitts coming in 1-0, but Pitts has been locked in.
I'll give it to him. He's still committing on those takedown attempts. He's level changing hard. I just think he needs to give Pitts something to respect up top, like you say, because he's shooting into offense right now, and Pitts doesn't seem to be slowing down.
This is our third of seven prelim fights. Pitts in the black. Hidalgo in the checkered red and black and white.
There you go. Pitts is doing a great job of, like, I don't want to say counter-strike him, but anytime Hidalgo comes in, he's pumping that jab out. He's landing his heavy strikes off of that jab. Right there, you see a double jab cross. Beautiful hook. Oh, nice.
The southpaw Pitts is really putting together some nice combinations throughout these first two rounds.
Nice.
Oh, my, there
that,
it goes.
That landed heavy. That 10 seconds left. Oh. Can he feel it? Another thing to note with Pitts, if you notice, he's kind of touching up top a little bit. Like, sometimes, like, if he's walking forward, he's kind of just, like, touch, 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 and then he'll rip. It's kind of like changing that tempo and that pace. They talk about it a lot in boxing, so I think that comes back to, like you say, his boxing training. He's almost, like, baiting him into a false sense of security, and then he just capitalizes, you know? It's like, he's not, everything isn't 100%. Like, sometimes he touches, sometimes he throws it fast, sometimes he throws it slow. He's doing a great job of changing the tempo, changing the pace, and that makes it hard for Hidalgo to read, you know what I mean? Because the strikes are coming at a different angles, different pacing. I definitely think we're seeing great striking experience here from Pitts, and I mean, I don't think anyone can dispute that he's two rounds up right now, so the Hidalgo corner's gonna have to press some urgency and hopefully give him some insight into how to change the direction of the fight coming out here in the third.
Especially the strong finish by Pitts there in the final 15 seconds of round two. As we approach the third and final round of our third fight on the prelims. Thank you for joining us on YouTube. Hope you're enjoying the start to an incredible night. We hope you join us on Fight Pass, 7 p.m. Pacific. No Glove touch here to kick off round three.
Nice job from Dalgo to throwing those body kicks in there. You know what I mean? Like you say, I just think he needs to be a little bit more offensive with his striking. I think that will open up those takedowns for him. Obviously, it's hard with a striker such as Pitts. Like I mentioned, you know, he's doing a great job of controlling the fight, even when he's not throwing stuff. You know, he's like feinting with his hands. He's touching. He's doing a good job of maintaining his range. You know, like very faint, like very small fakes, feints, pulls. And he's just making him miss very slightly, and I think that comes back down to that boxing experience that he has.
A lot of patience by Pitts, but if you're Hidalgo, you have to believe you're looking for a finish here in this final round.
Yeah, you gotta be. Pitts came, I personally feel like he came close in that second round to maybe being able to finish the fight. So Hidalgo's definitely gotta respect the power of Pitts. He doesn't seem to be slowing down coming out here in this third.
Uh-oh.
Beautiful.
And nice jab by Hidalgo there.
Yeah, I was about to say, you know, Pitts landed, but Hidalgo did a great job of landing on that jab. I don't love this outside single that he keeps shooting for. It's allowing Pitts to just kind of, like, stuff his head and land strikes. And he's back up to his feet. I'd like to maybe see some chain wrestling from Hidalgo. Maybe that could mix it up. Like I mentioned, obviously, throwing the strikes to the head and giving him some of the respect up there. But also some chain wrestling. You know, don't just fall down on the first takedown you've got. Maybe mix it up. You know, we saw in the previous fight, we saw one of the guys go single leg, switch to double leg. I'm enjoying watching striking, of course.
I mean, Hidalgo is, yes, he's 5-0 as an amateur, but I don't think he's faced such a disciplined striker like Michael Pitts thus far.
Yeah, definitely. And as you touched on, like, Pitts, despite his experience,
once again, shooting in,
is a phenomenal prospect here.
You can see how in control Pitts really is, though.
Yeah. And like I said, I'm not counting Hidalgo out. I think it's just a testament to him. You know, he's getting this test at the amateur level. It's only going to make him even better moving forwards. And both of these guys, despite, like say, only being amateurs, are performing at a professional level, in my opinion. Pitts looks so composed in there. It's a very impressive fight to kick off these prelims.
It's a massive opportunity for both of these fighters as Hard Rock Live in Sacramento is almost filled. 2,000 plus expected for tonight.
We've got 10 seconds left of this round. Unfortunately, I don't think Hidalgo is going to be able to do what needs to be done in order to win him this fight. But, you know, he didn't quit. I feel like he took some serious damage, some things that probably would have put other guys to sleep, and he kept pushing forward, kept pushing for those takedowns. You know, and he stayed relentless in there. So I do think that Pitts edged it on the judging, but I think both guys can come away with lots to be proud of here tonight and also plenty to work on. Pitts, despite only being 1-0, as I said, he performed way beyond his experience. Very impressive.
And to Hidalgo's credit, once again showing tremendous conditioning. In six of his fights, he has now gone the distance in all six. But Michael Pitts showed patience, he showed precision, and it appears that he will be showing himself to a second victory as an amateur, staying undefeated as we await the decision.
Got a replay coming over here. Beautiful backhands from Pitts. That double jab cross that I mentioned earlier. Really phenomenal boxing on display from Pitts here tonight. He did a great job level changing, loading up on his strikes. I was just very impressed with him here tonight, to be honest.
That was the flurry at the end of round two that really separated himself from dominant Hidalgo in this fight.
One thing to note, Hidalgo was throwing back. You know, he was staying semi-defensively sound, and he was staying within the fight. So, you know, just a testament to him also, because as we mentioned, Pitts is level way beyond his experience, you know what I mean? And for Hidalgo to stay in there and to be able to weather that storm and persevere and stay, you know, stay relentless on those takedowns, stay in that fight, is a true testament to him also. And even though, like you say, we think it's going to go to Pitts right now, I think he can hold his head up high.
Absolutely. Dominic Hidalgo is fearless. Six fights in just over a year. All the credit in the world to him. As we await the announcement, Derek Burton.
Ladies and gentlemen, for three rounds of action-packed action, we go to your three judges at cage side for the decision. Your first judge, Chad Shepard, sees it 29-28. while judges Don Mobley and Brenda Saucedo will see it 30-27, all for your winner by unanimous decision, Michael Pitts.
Unanimous decision victory for Michael Pitts. Congratulations to him. Also, tremendous performance by Dominic Hidalgo. As we await our fourth fight of the prelims, we'll be right back.
On his way to the cage, Conor Galloway.
It's now time for featherweight action. Conor Galloway, 1-1 in his amateur career with a submission victory. Came in yesterday at 145.1 at the weigh-ins. He made his debut this past October, went the distance in a decision loss back in January for 559 Fights, who we will be working with in the very near future. But like I said, his one victory was via submission, and he has a bright future.
Yeah, I actually watched that that debut of his. It was a round one submission, but very impressed with the performance. He came out, he knocked the guy down with his first 1-2, dove straight on the guy's back, and just stayed relentless on that rear naked choke for the following minute until eventually he got it. So. I actually had this pegged as my potential amateur fight of the night up until our next fight is probably going to be very exciting also. The comments on YouTube are going crazy for Falcone and Frosty right now. But this fight, I think, could be a very exciting fight also. Both guys are very aggressive. Conor Galloway has a very aggressive forward pressure style with relentless wrestling. He jumps on submissions, sometimes at a detriment and recklessly. But he's a very exciting fighter who comes out here, like I say, very eager to get that finish, and so does his opponent. So I'm really excited for this fight. I think it's going to be fast-paced, and I don't see it going the distance.
Ready now, making his way, Kyler Avila.
A lot of fans tonight here for sweet Kyler Avila, approaching the cage for the second time in his young career. Lost via decision in his pro debut back in December, but he's been training incredibly hard in jiu-jitsu and kickboxing. He feels like he has the offensive arsenal that is, over the past 3 months even, has improved greatly. And he is incredibly excited to get in the cage tonight.
Yeah, Kyler Avila, you know, 0-1-1, not obviously a preferential record, but at amateur, like we always say, it doesn't matter, you know what I mean? Amateur's just for experience. His last fight was in December, but it was an extremely close fight, which could have gone either way. And his debut against Amir Najjar, I might have said that wrong, I apologize, which was a draw, was a toe-to-toe battle. It was an extremely crowd-pleasing fight. It's actually one of the reasons why I have this fight pegged as, you know, one of the sleeper fights. Might be like kind of fight of the night for the prelim cards, because both guys are just, they're willing to stand toe to toe. They're aggressive. They don't hold back. Like I say, Avila fought Najjar, an extremely crowd pleasing fight. Had everyone out their seats, including Uriah Faber, who was also on the commentary with us.
Right.
And I just think both these guys are gonna come out here guns blazing. I don't see it going the distance, and I'm very excited for this one.
Let's not wait any longer. Let's kick it back to Garrett Fertig for the announcements.
A1 Combat now moves to the featherweight division, scheduled for 3 2-minute rounds, brought to you by the United States Air Force. And now we introduce first the blue corner, standing 6'1", weighing 145.1 pounds, with an amateur record of 1 win, 1 loss, including a first-round submission victory. He represents Castro MMA from Montica, California, Connor Galloway. And now we introduce the red corner, standing 6'1", weighing 145.4 pounds, looking for his first amateur victory. His record stands at 0 wins, 1 loss, and 1 draw. Representing Felipe Brancao, BJJ, and MMA from Orange Vale, California, Sweet Kyler Avila. Referee David Shirley.
Kyler Avila fighting out of the red corner, Galloway out of the blue. Our fourth fight of the prelims. Three 2-minute rounds.
Tentative glove touch there to start the round.
Corey, you were not kidding about the action of these two. They are ready to go.
Straight in on that takedown for Avila. Struggling to tell the pop. Yeesh. Both guys aggressive. Oh, heavy blows from Galloway. I told you, these guys do not hang about.
Oh, another left lands for Galloway.
Blasting through for Galloway. Honestly, I feel like he could have done with staying a little bit further away and landing the strikes, but beautiful reap there to get Avila down to the ground. These are only 2-minute rounds again, as we mentioned, because both guys have under 3 fights. However, I do not feel that we're going to miss out on any action here tonight with this fight. Both guys are, like I say, pushing the pressure from the bell.
Galloway certainly not wasting any time. A little bit of ground and pound. And oh, now he trying to get the back.
Try to jump the back, but Avila's done a great job of staying aware in that position. He got his shoulders back to the mat. He is against the cage. However, Galloway is in half guard, which kind of makes it a little harder to use the cage to get up because he is blocking off that hip with his knees. Mm-hmm. Loving the head positioning of Galloway right here. Keeping in Avila's face, keeping that pressure, allowing him to land some ground and pound. Mm-hmm. 20 seconds left at the first round. And as we say,
it's been all Galloway.
Yeah, Galloway is, sorry, I had to take a second to check. Someone needs to, they need different color shades.
Oh, Avila back to his feet with a nice right hand, but Galloway comes right back.
That overhand connected, but Galloway was not shook. He shook that off
upcoming
like it was nothing
for A1
and stayed
Friday,
in Avila's
May 17th,
face.
A1-20, wow. Right back here at the Hard Rock Live. Then Friday, May 24th, A1-21.
That first round was as good as advertised.
Followed by Saturday, June 29th.
With Connor Galloway and Kyler Avila.
From the DoubleTree here in Sacramento.
So definitely got Galloway up for that round, obviously. I don't think that could be disputed. But definitely not counting Avila out. Glad to see some of the action right here from this first round. Heavy blows from both guys on both sides.
Galloway unaffected, though, by that right hand. It was really the aggression of Galloway that took control for the majority of the first round. And a couple of nice combinations and some ground and pound as well.
Yeah, Galloway has no respect for the striking of Avila. He took those shots as if they were nothing, and he pressed straight back in and landed some big ones of his own.
Yeah.
But like you say, both guys looking very impressive, very aggressive. And I'll be surprised if this fight goes the distance.
They both have tremendous conditioning. Bit of an issue with the cage. We'll get that fixed momentarily, I believe. This is our fourth fight on the prelims, and coming up next, we have the fight that a lot of people on YouTube are waiting to see.
Oh, these comments are crazy. I'm reading these comments whilst we're commentating on these fights, you know, between the rounds a little bit, keeping an eye on it. And everybody is arguing in the comment sections about Falcone versus Cortez. You know, I definitely think there's going to be an upset here tonight. I don't want to pick it. I don't want to see who. I don't want to pick who's going to win. Obviously, Frosty's a teammate of mine, but I am extremely excited. That's got Fight of the Night written all over it. Two young prospects, yes. And I'd say I think everybody on the YouTube stream is tuning in to watch that fight here tonight.
And the entire YouTube stream is arguing with each other, which you love to see it as we are underway here, round two.
Just look at the composure on the face of Galloway. You know, he's just unfazed. And, oh, beautiful.
Wow.
He is running Avila down.
Galloway charging right in once again and really just teeing off. Avila doing his best to cover up now into the clinch.
And this comes back to what I was saying about how, like, sometimes he's a little bit reckless and it's a detriment to himself with the way he jumps on stuff. I think if he had just stayed back a little bit, kept a little bit more range, he would have honestly been able to keep teeing off on Avila and potentially have. I don't say he finished the fight. You know, Avila's still very much in this fight, but he's having a lot of beautiful lat drop. Yeah, very, very impressed with Galloway here. He's very composed despite only being 1-1 as an amateur. Yeah, very, very impressed. Sorry, just kind of lost for words a little bit. Oh, guillotine attempt from Avila.
Yeah.
That could be in. Oh, he uses it to sweep. Oh. Beautiful job from Avila. He's under the chin there. Smart to let go of it. He's ridden out to the back. Great positional awareness from Avila there. Like I say, like, not counting him out. Both guys are solid prospects. He did a great job of knowing when to let go of that guillotine. He used it to sweep. He felt he didn't have it. He let go of it. And he used Galloway's momentum to almost like ride it out and take the back. That was beautiful jiu-jitsu awareness right there.
Maintaining control. And Avila has been training at Braggio BJJ.
Seconds left of the round. Not sure if he's going to be able to get it done right here. You know, we're short on time, but phenomenal from Avila to turn it around here.
But nonetheless, you'd probably give round two.
I think these ground and pound right here is going to seal the deal. And the judges, I say a round of peace as we go into the third.
Sponsor is Tetra Construction, a California-based construction company.
This has been so impressive. Connor Galloway really in control for much of round two. But it was Avila that utilized his grappling skills in round two.
Yeah, this fight is not disappointing. You know, I knew it was going to be action-packed coming out. I knew both guys were very hungry, very aggressive young prospects. And, yeah, very impressed with both guys here. We got a replay coming up. You see the aggression of Galloway as he runs forwards towards Avila. And this close guillotine from Avila. You know, this was in. He did a beautiful job of using it to sweep, taking the mount, and he was very composed. And it's fight IQ right here, knowing when to abandon a submission out of risk of losing position, and he used it to take the back. It's perfect.
It was very close there. Avila really had it locked in for a couple of seconds, but like you said, Corey, he maintained control for the majority of that round. As we approach our third and final round, once again, 2-minute rounds here. Ooh. Avila in the black and gray, Galloway in the black and red, and another shot lands.
Swing and a miss on that one, but the one before landed clean. I think, got distracted by the screen, but no, I think, you know, Galloway's doing a great job closing distance. He's got his underhook.
Yeah.
Probably gonna look to take it back to the ground, but like I say, Avila did a great job of reversing position in the last round, and I definitely think we can see confidence growing for Avila here.
We are looking at two fighters who know this is a very even fight, and this round is going to determine who gets their hand raised. Oh, hold on a second, going for the triangle. Avila going for the triangle, but Galloway wise to it.
Good job from Galloway there. You know, both of these guys seem very composed, very positionally aware. You know, he did a great job there. He felt the threat of the triangle and then the armbar coming up, and he did a great job of posturing and fighting the position.
Oh, Avila not giving up on that triangle, though. Oh, the ground and pound now by Galloway.
Ooh. Oh, brutal head kick. Galloway is one of those guys that, you know, he throws with reckless abandon, and he definitely has finishing power behind those punches. Avila also, you know, he landed some big strikes. He's done a great job on the ground to stay offensive, keep attacking, like I say, throwing up submissions. Got a sweep in the last round. Yeah, we're seeing great stuff from both these guys despite being early in their amateur career.
Final 25 seconds of a wildly entertaining fight between Avila and Galloway.
I think that stunned Galloway a little bit.
Certainly did. But as you mentioned,
seconds.
Galloway just keeps throwing.
I know, I thought he stumbled for a minute there, but he seems to have recovered his composure. Probably a good idea to close that gap and get back in on these on this cage pressure. He did look a little stunned, but that third round was close. I mean,
yeah.
Wow, yeah, great fight from both guys. It's one of those fights where I kind of wish we had those 3 minute rounds, gonna see a little bit more from both these guys. Did not disappoint, you know, like say, like 2 minute rounds, but they use every second of it.
Very difficult decision for the judges. I mean, you look at the third round, there were a couple of moments where Avila was close to getting a triangle locked in, so obviously that would probably go into play with the judges' decision, perhaps.
I'm gonna go with Galloway. I think the ground pound, but we're about to see this rock here. Like when Avila landed. Wait, there you go. Oh, we didn't quite see it. Oh no.
That's the one. There you go.
That uppercut and that hurt right there. That was a great connection from Avila, but I just feel like Galloway had more forward pressure.
Okay.
He had that ground and pound. Avila did throw up some submissions, but he wasn't really close on them. Kind of was attacking the arm, but was on the wrong hip for it. He did a good job of staying offensive, but I just feel like Galloway had the advantage on the, aside from, I mean, he did get rocked, but.
The most powerful shot there
was. He had the ground and pound. He had the, he had the cage pressure. He was pushing forward. He ran him down at the start. I wouldn't be upset if it went the other way, but I'm personally leaning towards Galloway.
Okay. The decision is in as Garrett Fertig entering the cage. You're looking at the screen right now. That's Galloway on the left, Avila on the right. Let's find out who won.
Ladies and gentlemen, for 3 rounds of action-packed action, we go to 3 judges at cage side for the decision. All 3 judges, Chad Shepard, Don Mobley, and Brandon Salcedo, all see it the same, 29-28. For your winner by unanimous decision, Connor Galloway.
I'm gonna go into judging afterwards.
Well, Corey, you called it there. Connor Galloway, congratulations, moving to 2-1 in his amateur career, but what a performance by both sweet Kyler Avila and Connor Galloway.
And unfortunate for Kyler Avila, his record does not reflect his level, but it's just a testament that he's pushing himself early in his career, and I'm sure he's going to come back even better from this. He looked phenomenal out there. He did so many things right. Obviously, stuff for him and his team to go away and work on, but very impressed with both guys here.
Absolutely. Well, we'll be right back. It is time for Frosty and Falcone.
Set now to make his amateur debut, Kevin Falcone.
What a moment this is for Kevin Falcone. He's had quite the life's journey, born in Philadelphia, but moved to Uruguay at a very young age. But this past year moved to California to raise up his game to get to the next level. Training at the American Kickboxing Academy, extensive training in Sanda, which is a very unique martial art, and he's very, very confident tonight.
Yeah, like I say, his debut, his camo profile says 4 months of training MMA, and I when I saw that, I was like, okay, this guy's been training some other martial arts. I want to check out his Instagram. In 2022, he's competed in 3 martial arts. He won 2 South American championships, yep. 2 national titles. He went 15-1. He's got plenty of kickboxing experience, multiple highlight reel-worthy knockouts. This this kid's good, you know, despite his training out at AKA, a great team. This guy has experience way beyond his, you know, his record of 0-0. And it's going to be a true test in Frosty tonight. But, you know, Frosty is a solid prospect training at Team Alpha Male. Again, like, we'll talk about him in a second when he walks out. But I think from looking at the comments here on YouTube, this is the people's main event right here.
Absolutely. Amazing accomplishments, as we'll get to Frosty as soon as he makes his entrance. But, you know, I talked to Falcone. He is so proud of the fact that he won the Sonda South American Championship in 2022. As you mentioned, national kickboxing champion. It's really just a natural progression for Falcone to get into the cage. And this is going to be very exciting here in this lightweight clash. 3 rounds, 2 minutes for each round.
Returning to A1 Combat, please welcome Eric Cortez.
Well, it's not just YouTube, it's a lot of people in Sacramento here to see Frosty Cortez.
Yeah, I think most of the crowd here has turned up tonight, Frosty. This right here is the Battle of the Prospects. You know, we got AKA in the corner of Falcone. I believe that's Cain Velasquez over there. And
yeah,
then, you know, for Frosty Cortez, he is the Team Alpha Male prospect. You know, he's in his corner right now. We've got Fabio, we've got Alex Sandoval, you know, ex-UFC fighter. We've got Marcus, who does the boxing with everybody. You know, like, both guys can have high-level teams, both highly talented prospects, both with great experience. You know, Frosty's 1-0. He actually also fought in Hawaii, upper weight class, against Adrian Lee, the brother of ONE champions, Christian and Angela Lee. He got silver at the IMF Youth World Championships. He's a multiple-time state wrestling and California state champ. You know, he's won so many wrestling tournaments. You know, the Las Vegas Freak Show in an 82-man bracket. I can list off this kid's accolades just as we could for Falcone. So, like I say, Battle of the Prospects, the people's main event, and I am extremely excited for this fight right here.
Let's get it started. Garrett Furtick, take it away.
Our next bout this evening is sponsored by Glass West, set for 3 2-minute rounds in the lightweight division. Introducing first, the blue corner. Standing 5'9" tall, weighing 155 pounds. Tonight he makes his amateur MMA debut, representing AKA San Jose from Montevideo, Uruguay. Please welcome Kevin Falcone. And now introducing his opponent, fighting out of the red corner. Standing 5'9" tall, weighing 153.9 pounds. After a unanimous decision victory in his amateur debut, he returns to A1 Combat 1-0, representing Team Alpha Male from Sacramento, California. Please welcome Eric Frosty Cortez. Your referee, Mike Mentra.
Cortez fighting out of the red corner, Falcone out of the blue. 3 2-minute rounds in this lightweight clash. To those of you watching on YouTube, this is the fight you're waiting for.
Three two-minute rounds. You know, I got a feeling by the end of this fight, we're not going to be wanting for more. This, like I say, both two young, hungry prospects. A lot of comments that touch on, you know, Frosty has just turned 18. You know, like I say, like, kid's a young stud. The crowd just erupted. So, like I mentioned, a lot of people here tonight to watch this fight and on YouTube.
And you mentioned all the accolades for Eric Cortez. On top of that, purple belt in BJJ as well. And you mentioned only 18 years old to be this accomplished. It just goes to show what an amazing athlete both he and Falcone both are.
Good job from Frosty to be holding the center. You know, it came out, he shot early, but didn't get it, but he's doing a good job of, you know, pressing Falcone back. Oh, beautiful connection, that hook, and straight in on that double leg.
Falcone caught it, but yeah, great aggression there.
You know, and Falcone's coming out of AKA, you know, we know they have great wrestling, a great wrestling base. Obviously, most of his experience does seem to come from kickboxing. Don't really know too much about him. Obviously, he hasn't had any MMA experience, so there's not too much to watch on him. But, you know, with Frosty's wrestling pedigree, you would think that this is obviously where the fight's going to go.
Right to the ground.
Good job from Frosty. Great job to square him up to the cage, take away his ability to wall walk and get up to his feet. Very smart game plan here from Frosty.
Final 25 seconds.
Nice ground pound. And only, like you say, only 20 seconds left of this round. These 2 minute rounds are going
very
insanely
difficult.
Fast.
2 minute rounds, very difficult.
Good job from Frosty to be controlling the cage, pressuring forward, and insisting on this takedown early in the fight. Just dictating the direction of this round.
Frosty, some snappy leg kicks there. Final seconds of round one. Oh, nice kick by Falcone.
And just to touch on that, one of those knockouts that I mentioned that I saw from Falcone was a head kick knockout, and it was brutal. So, you know, Frosty does have to stay aware in those positions that Falcone has danger. He has finishing power. But Frosty's doing a great job of negating that with his wrestling. So, you know, like I say, both guys amazing prospects. I'd say that first round goes to Frosty. Obviously, we got a replay right here. That hook into that takedown was beautiful.
Yeah, it was.
Frosty.
And that's what you have to love about fights like this, such a contrast of styles. You have Falcone, tremendously accomplished kickboxer, but then Cortez wants to take this to the ground, and we saw a little bit of both in that first round.
Great job from Frosty. You notice when he got back up to his feet, he was throwing those leg kicks whilst Falcone was on his back, staying in his face, staying active, and that adds up with the judges also. A lot of people break and kind of like they use that time, that separation as like kind of time to rest or time to let your opponent get back up. Frosty's doing a great job of staying active. Like I say, you've got to capitalize on that with these short rounds, because you don't have much time to, you know, to win over these judges.
And as a fighter, Corey, when you're facing a kickboxer, essentially distance is not really your friend. So if you're Cortez, you really want to keep things close.
Yeah, like I say, Falcone has great kickboxing, and that's not to take away from Frosty. Frosty works very hard. He's in the gym every single day, multiple times a day. The kid was homeschooled. He pretty much did, like, he spent from like 6 a.m. to 9 p.m. a night in the gym. You know, he trains hard. Oh, connection on that backhand there. He's got to be careful. Might have been a bit more of a slip. Anyway, going back to that. Frosty trains really hard, but I definitely think he needs to just press on this wrestling and totally negate that kickboxing from Falcone, because Falcone is, you know, he's a scary prospect. He's got finishing power, and he's very composed in there, which I think just is a testament to his experience.
Falcone certainly trying to dictate the pace a little more in the opening moments of the second round here. Almost halfway through the second round already.
Beautiful entry there from Frosty. Falcone landing damage here in this position. Big lift from Frosty, and we're gonna see a slam.
Look at the power of Frosty. Cortez taking down Falcone.
Beautiful job. And this is where, you know, Frosty needs to take it. I hate to say it, like, you know, Falcone landed some big strikes there on the feet, and he throws them so fast you almost can't see him. So I definitely think it's smart from Frosty and his corner to be taking this to the ground.
He did that in an impressive way once again in this second round here. Final 30 seconds. Who can mount a strong flurry here to finish out the second round?
Falcone needs to press urgency to get to his feet. You know, we got 10 seconds left of this round. I think that big slam definitely, again, sealed the deal for Frosty. He's coming out of this round with two up. Big ground and pound for Frosty. Great job.
Nice little combination there to finish out the second round. We're heading to a third, ladies and gentlemen. This is our fifth fight on the prelims. Two more to go before the main card, 7 p.m. Pacific on Fight Pass. As we go back to check out some of the action of round two, and nice right hand there.
I don't think I connected, actually. That might have been a bit of a slip on Frosty's behalf, but beautiful slam on this. He got him over his head. He ran him towards his corner, and he slammed him.
That's worth a second look. As Cortez takes down Falcone and then finishes strong in round two.
And a big flurry. at the end here for Frosty with that ground and pound, staying active. Falcone got to his feet, but I think he just needs to push that urgency on that a little bit earlier with these takedowns. Like we mentioned, the rounds are short. There's no time to be hanging out in close guard, especially if you're not an offensive jiu-jitsu player.
Both fighters still look fresh and ready to go. Final round underway. Nice kick by Falcone.
Nice, beautiful fake from Frosty there, land that 1-2. Falcone swinging these hooks and they are brutal. Like if they land, I do think Frosty's in for a rough night, but Frosty's doing a great job of like, he's adding those level changes, those small fakes, those small pulls.
Yeah.
Very impressed with him here tonight.
Frosty's very evasive. Incredible training leading up to this fight.
And he's also doing what we touched on earlier. You know, we mentioned about Hidalgo diving on those takedowns recklessly. Frosty's engaging a little bit on the feet. He's giving him something to respect up top, and that's allowing him to shoot in on these takedowns. It's just opening up the hips of Falcone.
Approaching the final minute of this fight.
Falcone doing a better job of pushing forwards, controlling the cage now instead of letting Frosty back him up to the cage. You know, unless he can finish the fight here in this last minute, I do think we're looking at Frosty on the scorecards.
Falcone certainly being the aggressor in this one.
Yeah, Frosty landed a heavy overhand there. We saw spit fly. You nearly got your suit a little wet.
No matter who comes out on top, this is as good as advertised. Two incredibly skilled young fighters, both so accomplished throughout their athletic careers, and it brought them to this moment tonight. Whoa, wow.
20 seconds left of this round, and both guys are throwing with heat.
So Falcone just looking for an opening here. Final moments.
I feel like Falcone just, you know, he stepped it up, turned it on a little bit too
nice
late.
Combo.
He's swinging and missing.
Haymaker being thrown to close out this fight. As Corey McKenna is about to corner. Walter Shaw in our next fight, so it's just gonna be myself riding with you here for a few moments. But what a way to close out the third round. Kevin Falcone and Eric Cortez, two very talented athletes, two incredibly gifted fighters. The sky's the limit for both of them as we check out the third round here. And Falcone was firing away with a combination of kicks, a combination of strikes, but Cortez had tremendous counter punches throughout this fight, as we see evidence of that in the third round. Not an easy decision for the judges. Will Cortez move to 2-0, or will Falcone win his amateur debut? That remains the question. Coming up next, we're going to see Walter Shaw and Chase Miles in welterweight action, followed by the welterweight title on the line, Rafael Vega and Eddie McCleary. And once again, three title fights on the main card, live on UFC Fight Pass, 7 p.m. Pacific. If you're watching on YouTube, thank you so much for joining us. It's been a great, great night thus far for our prelims. Important dates to remember, May 17th, A1 Combat 20 coming up right back here in Sacramento. And then A1 Combat 21, only 8 days later on May 25th from the Visalia Convention Center. And that'll be on Fight Pass. First of our title fights on the main card is going to be crowning the first ever men's strawweight championship, followed by the middleweight title on the line. And then in the main event, Ernie Juarez will be defending the featherweight title, as it looks like the decision is in. Let's go to Garrett Fertig.
Ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds of action-packed action, we go to your three judges at cage side for the decision. Your first judge, Chad Shepard, scores the contest 29-28, Falcone. Your second judge, Don Mobley, scores the contest 29-28, Cortez. And your third and final judge, Brandon Salcido, sees it 30-27 for your winner by split decision, Eric Frosty Cortez.
Eric Cortez moving to 2-0 as an amateur. Great sign of respect by these two tremendous athletes. Kevin Falcone has so much to be proud of in his amateur debut. He has such a bright future, as of course does Frosty Cortez, as he will celebrate with his camp and many of the people in attendance here at Hard Rock Live. Two more fights left on the prelims. Don't go anywhere.
And now, making his A1 combat debut, Chase Miles.
Chase Miles, coming in with an amateur record of 3-1 with one knockout, one submission. Miles has definitely proven to be a strong grappler in his young career. And both victories, the knockout and submission, were in the first round. So he is looking to build on top of that momentum tonight in our co-main for the prelims. Miles came in yesterday at the weigh-ins, 169.3. And we will see three-minute rounds here. As right now I'm being joined by the newest member of our broadcast team. Could not be more excited to have him here. You know him from so many different promotions and shows with UFC, TJ DeSantis. Hello, sir.
Hello. I'm happy to be here. This is fun. You know, it's fun to kick off the night with amateur fights.
Yeah. It's been action-packed, to say the least, for the first five fights, as Garrett Fertig is ready.
Set now to make his way, this is Walter Shaw.
Walter Shaw, 2-3 thus far in his amateur career with one knockout. It's his second trip to the A1 Combat cage, the former being a first-round knockout debut all the way back at A1 Combat 5. This will be his first fight since August, so certainly no lack of motivation for Shaw. And, you know, the game plan for him, his camp told me it's going to be a bit of sprawl and brawl, uses range to his advantage. And certainly the biggest spotlight that Shaw has had in his career thus far.
When you talk about that spotlight, Johnny, I think about, you know, the experience here. When you're an amateur, it's important to get as many looks as you can before you make that move to decide to go pro. And when you can fight under lights like this on a platform to a worldwide audience, you're going to become better, not just with your skills inside the cage, but your ability to handle the bright lights. And this wasn't the case 15 years ago. You know, back in the day, you'd be fighting in rodeo rings, not big casinos like this.
And everyone loves a good rodeo. But
true.
Nonetheless, the Hard Rock Live is maybe a step up.
Absolutely.
Well, you've been working in combat sports for quite a long time. It's a difficult decision to go from amateur to pro. It really is not just a singular decision. You have to really take a lot of different advice into it, I would imagine.
Yeah, it's a team-based sport, and I think if you are a fighter that thinks it's time to go pro, you might want to have a conversation with your coach first, because I think it's a decision that has to be made, you know, as a group.
Sticky's Slabs Barbecue presents our next amateur welterweight bout, set for three. Three-minute rounds. Introducing first, the blue corner, standing 5 feet, 11 inches tall, his official weight, 169.3 pounds. Holding an amateur record of 3 wins, 1 loss, representing Klingon's MMA and kickboxing from Sutter, California, please welcome Chase Marshall Miles. And now introducing his opponent, fighting out of the red corner, standing 6 feet tall, weighing 170.4 pounds, 2-1 at A1 Combat, and 2-3 overall. As an amateur, he represents Team Alpha Male from Guam. Please welcome Walter Shaw. Your referee, Herb Dean.
Both fighters having a strong contingent here in attendance tonight. As we're set for three-minute rounds here in this welterweight clash, and of course the welterweight title for the amateurs will be up for grabs in our main event. And we'll be running right down to the wire, it appears, for the main card.
You mentioned three-minute rounds, you know, at the amateur level. That feels like a sprint to a lot of pros, and you got to really go out there and sort of, you know, force your fight when you only have 3 minutes each round to try to convince the judges if it goes that far.
Chase Miles in the green trunks. Walter Shaw in the gray and blue. Ooh, nice jab.
Talk about the experience gained here. You know, southpaw fighting an orthodox fighter, you don't
right.
run into that, you know, every day. And that's something you definitely want to try to work the kinks out of when you're an amateur rather than doing it for the first time in the pro state.
Chase Miles shoots in, successful takedown. Miles did say he was very confident in taking this fight to the ground.
Well, nice Kimura look here. More an interesting submission. Not going to be able to get it here, but it's one that in that position, now armbar upcoming.
Oh, wait a minute.
Elbow might be free. Still putting torque, though, down on that forearm.
Difficult angle, but you see Chase Miles.
Wow, tap.
Was
it is
that
done.
Was a
Herb
tap.
Dean calls it.
We
might
did not
have been
see
a tap. It might not have been a tap, but it's eerily reminiscent of Frank Mir and Tim Sylvia. And Herb Dean was the referee
yeah.
in that fight where Frank Mir broke the forearm of Tim Sylvia, and Herb pulled it off. And basically, Herb was the only one in the building that night that knew that the arm was broken. Tonight, I don't know if we have a broken arm. I don't know if we have a tap. But again, it's an amateur fight, and Herb saved the fighter potentially from himself.
Well, number one, you have the memory of an elephant. That is so impressive to call that back. But wow, Chase Miles with an impressive takedown. But Walter Shaw maintained his composure and gains a first-round submission victory. Truly incredible. It was a very difficult angle for us to see.
Yeah,
but Chase Miles, there was anguish in his face, and he had to tap.
Absolutely, and the torque from this armbar, obviously you're trying to extend and hyperextend the elbow, but
yeah.
you're going to see this. All of the pressure, the fulcrum, if you will, was on that forearm, it looked like. I mean,
yeah, you could see maybe the hyperextension there on the left.
Elbow
wow.
still might be in there, but
Walter Shaw using his entire body at just the perfect angle there. As we go to Garrett Fertig for the announcement.
The armbar brings on the finish at 1 minute, 19 seconds of round number one. Declaring your winner by submission, Walter Shaw.
Walter Shaw evening his amateur record at 3-3. We talked about when it's time for a fighter to make that move to the professional ranks. Well, now might be that time for Walter Shaw, but nonetheless, it's about to be main event time for the vacant welterweight title. Don't go anywhere.
Set now for our featured prelim, please welcome Eddie McCleary.
Wild horse Eddie McCleary. Very interesting story. He's 3-0 as an amateur, but TJ, he has not fought since 2010.
That's more than a decade ago.
We had to go to Camo to find his previous fights.
What were you doing in 2010?
Certainly not anything as fun as this.
I mean, I'm sure you were a different person. And I mentioned that because you changed so much over the course of years as a fighter. And if there's any tape that could be found of him, probably not something you can even go on.
It was difficult. You know, I tried to reach out to him on social media. Couldn't find anything there. A bit of an enigma trying to do research on him. But we did find he's 3-0 as an amateur, 2 first round TKOs, 1 submission victory. So obviously he's proved to be very dangerous, but you'd have to imagine after 14 years, this is really personal for Eddie McCleary to come back.
Yeah, in a lot of ways, you know, that journey for a martial artist, it takes a lot of twists and turns, and, you know, we don't necessarily know what kept him away from active competition, but,
right.
You know, returning tonight after such a long time away, that might be a victory in itself. Now he wants to have some fun.
You can definitely see some joy in his face as he jumps in that cage.
And now we welcome his opponent, Rafael Vega.
Now on the opposite end, you have Rafael Vega who, well, he goes by the Relentless with good reason. 5-0 as an amateur. This will be his 6th fight since February of 2023. That is a hectic and impressive schedule.
Absolutely. And, you know, with more reps comes more experience. More experience comes more prep. And it's pretty clear that this gentleman probably wants to take this to the pro ranks, and he's doing everything he can to stay as active as possible and make it there.
2 knockouts, 2 submissions. In his young career, he's, quite frankly, he's been dominant. Also tossed in a unanimous decision victory, and, you know, he's walking in 5-0, looking to win this vacant A1 combat amateur welterweight title.
And that would be a statement. Obviously, you know, a title at any level states that you're the best among your peers. And, you know, I think about the amateur format, 3 3-minute rounds. You have to learn how to, you know, play favor to the judges in mixed martial arts. There's going to be even matches. And not that you ever want to fight to win a decision when you could otherwise get a stoppage, but, you know, fight IQ goes a long way. And getting that as an amateur to know what the judges look for, that says something.
As we check out the tail of the tape, obviously 12 years age disparity, 3-1 Eddie McCleary, 5-0 Rafael Vega, 4-inch height advantage, and just about even on the weight. Very intriguing title match here as Garrett Fertig will set the stage.
Able coming down to conclude their prelims, set for 3 3-minute rounds for the vacant A1 Combat Welterweight Championship. This evening's amateur title fight are sanctioned by the California Amateur Mixed Martial Arts Organization. And now we introduce first the blue corner. Standing 6'2" tall, his official weight 169.4 pounds, entering this evening 3-1 as an amateur, representing Britto MMA from Sacramento, California. Please welcome Eddie Wild Horse McCleary. And now introducing his opponent across the cage, fighting out of the red corner, standing 5'10" tall, weighing 169 pounds even, undefeated in his amateur career with 5 wins, no losses. 2 of his 5 wins coming by submission, representing MMA Gold. Also from Sacramento, California, the relentless Rafael Fega.
California for amateurs. Number one in Vega.
Obey my commands at all times, defend yourself at all times. Touch the left now, come on, ready to bang.
The referee for the A1 combat amateur welterweight championship, David Shirley.
David Shirley will be officiating this fight here. As I was mentioning, Vega, the number one ranked amateur in Nevada, number two in California, number three overall on the West Coast. Vega fighting out of the red corner, McCleary out of the blue. We are underway, three-minute rounds. Amateur welterweight title up for grabs here for A1 combat, and whoa, Vega shooting it immediately.
Able to stick with the takedown and get on top and secure this position. Half butterfly for McCleary. Passes that guard like butter, wow.
I mean, over the course of Vega's 5 fights, he's been the aggressor. So not shocking that he's setting the tone here early on.
Think about, you know, he's been this aggressor with, you know, limited weapons as an amateur. When he goes up to the pro ranks, he's gonna have knees and elbows and a lot more to his disposal. And I mean, even without those things, I think this mount might be pretty dangerous.
Absolutely. Just under a minute into round one, and now some hammer fist raining down. McCleary trying to cover up here.
Yeah, not taking a lot of punishment here, but this isn't really necessarily intelligent defense, and that's what it comes down to, whether or not you're allowed to continue to fight. He needs to try to move and improve his situation. Now he goes belly down.
That is not where McCleary wants to be. Vega taking the back. Difficult to see if he has it locked in.
There's a tap. It is done.
Just like that, Rafael Vega remains undefeated and becomes the new A1 Combat Amateur Welterweight Champion. Just over a minute. TJ, we talk about how dominant he has been. He certainly continued that trend.
Absolutely, and now he's got some hardware for his troubles. And the question is, how many times will he look to defend this title? Or, you know, is the opportunity to go pro? What's next? Because I would love to see him, you know, with more tools at his disposal.
TJ, you have to believe, with all these performances now, 3 submissions, 2 knockouts, unanimous decision victory. At some point, you make the jump.
I mean, you gotta be impressed by the fact that some guy took him the distance with how dominant this guy is. So yeah, he's done everything, you know, so far in his power. Now he's getting some hardware for the trophy room. And I can't wait to watch his career progress and move forward.
Well, hopefully we'll be calling more of his fights for A1 Combat in the very near future as we go to check out the action here. Just over a minute in for the submissions. It was all Vega from the opening seconds, from the hammer fist, and then to the tap. Once he got the back, that was curtains.
Yeah, all action, one-way traffic, if you will. He got the takedown, passed the guard, took mount, got the back, took home the neck, now he's taking home the belt.
All the pressure of the RNC forcing McCleary to tap, and Rafael Vega, the new welterweight champion. Let's go to Garrett Fertig.
The rear naked choke brings on the finish. 1:11 of round number one. Declaring your winner by submission. And now, the A1 Combat Amateur Welterweight Champion, Relentless, Rafael Vega.
6 victories in just under 14 months. That is a schedule that most would aspire to have.
That's a belt I think a lot would aspire to have as well. Getting it from the California kid, Uriah Faber. I mean, what a statement made here by this young man. And again, I can't wait to see the next step in his evolution and progression.
No doubt about that. What a way to close out the prelims for A1 Combat 19. Thank you for joining us live on YouTube. But in just about 20 minutes, 7 p.m. Pacific, we will go live on UFC Fight Pass for A1 Combat 19. TJ and I will be right back with you.